Good afternoon, everyone. Hope everybody got plenty to eat. Not too much, though. Not too much. You don't need to get sleepy. We're about to begin our afternoon service today. I'd like to remind everyone that following this, we will have a family meeting, so you'll need to hang around for that. Again, encourage everyone to pick up a bulletin, quite a bit of information in there. A few things I'd like to bring to your attention before we get started. There are new cards, calls, and fellowship groups that are in the works right now. David Strickland will put those together, and he'll be going around and giving you your new cards soon, and those groups will begin to meet next week, the 5th of February. Also next week, we have our Hickory Woods service. And if you're interested in helping out with that or just need some information on it, curious, Brandon Beard, John Skorick, that's who you're going to want to talk to for that. As I mentioned this morning, sympathies extended to the Jackson family. Charlene Jackson's brother passed away this past week. We'd like to remember his wife, Janet, and just the whole Jackson family. Keep them in your prayers. Also mentioned this morning, Tim Dunnigan. He's a longtime employee for Second Harvest Food Bank. He passed away. No, his wife passed away this week, and earlier in the month, wasn't it, Aubrey?
January the
10th, so I'd like to keep that family in our prayers. Also, I learned just a little while ago, Perry Taylor, who is the minister at Jefferson Pike Church, his dad passed away this week, Richard Taylor, so we want to keep that family in our prayers. And also, speaking with Harry Anderson a little bit ago, one of his sons fell this week. His name is John Anderson, and he broke his hip, so we would like to keep that family in our prayers as well. I have a card here I'd like to read to you. This card is from Mr. Tom Bain, 95 years old this week. And he sent a thank you card. Thank you for the visits and all my birthday cards. Christian love, Thomas Bain. So that's quite an achievement. Now we will begin our service.
Can we get all the little ones up front, those sixth grade and under? So we'll do our kids sing here. And all right. There's two. All right. Good job, good job. Come on down. We've got about three so far, who've completed the card. So very proud of y'all for doing that. I want y'all to keep working on that, so we can get some more of y'all some medals. We're gonna work on this one. We're gonna work on this card for this is the last of this month. We're gonna work on it all the month of February, and then we're gonna be switching over to 1st and 2nd Corinthians. All right, so let's work hard. We got about another month and a week, 5 or 6 weeks to try to learn all that and earn you a medal out of it. Okay, so we got a couple more. We'll wait till everybody gets down here. All right, gotta get the front pew full. Very good. All right. Are we ready? How many books in the Bible?
66.
All right, very good. How many in the Old Testament?
39.
How many in the New Testament?
27.
All right, let's say them. Genesis.
Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes,
Malachi, very good. That's all 39 of the old. Let's do the New Testament. Matthew. Revelation. All right, very good job. Awesome. All right, let's go ahead and get started on our Fact 1 Bible card. Y'all want to come on up? Come on up. Yeah, come on in here. We got room for all. We have to make a little bit of room. This way. Hey, Adam. Alan, right here, buddy. Front row. There you go. Front row seat, man. You're in the best spot in the house. Just find you a spot. Y'all scoot in tight. Let them scoot in tight and give them some room. There you go. There you go. There you go. Scoot in tight. There you go. There. Hey, Lucas, y'all move in right here. There you go. Get in there, buddy. There we go. Wow, that's all right. We got an awesome road this time. That's great. We may have to clear out that second road if we keep on like this. All right. Thank you, Brother David. All right, we say creation. Where is it? Flood. Sodom and Gomorrah. Joseph sold by his brothers. Plague. How many plagues? Very good. Ten Commandments. Hannah.
1 Samuel 1.
David fights Goliath.
1 Samuel 17.
Naaman's leprosy. 5. Sermon on the Mount. Model prayer. 12 apostles. Death of John the Baptist. Marriage and divorce. Proper place for preachers. Judgment Day. Death of Jesus. Great Commission. Let's see. Birth of Jesus. Luke 2. Birth of the church. Birth of Sunday worship preaching. Withdrawal of fellowship. It's 5. Very good. All right. Lord's Supper. Love. Contribution. All right, qualifications for elders and deacons. 1 Timothy chapter 3. What is the chapter that is known as the faith chapter? Hebrews 11, good marriage. We want to know about heaven? Revelation 21, very good. All right. Raise your hand if you know what the definition of a successful life is.
What is the definition of a successful life?
Take a die.
Well, that's good, but that's not quite what we're looking for.
Live your life and go to heaven.
Live your life and go to heaven. That is the definition of a successful life. What is the definition of an unsuccessful life? To live your life, no matter what you accomplish, if you don't go to heaven, you have not had a successful life. All right, what is God's ideal for marriage?
A man and a woman for life.
All right, one man and one woman for life. And the last question is, if I grow up and I get married, who am I going to marry?
A Christian.
All right, very good. All right, so let's sing a one that we haven't sung yet, but I think most of y'all are familiar with. Anybody know anything about wise men? All right, we've got to build on something if we're a wise man, right? All right, the wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. And the rain came tumbling down. Oh, the rain came down as the floods came up. The rain came down as the flood came up, and the wise man's house stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rain came tumbling down. Oh, the rain came down as the floods came up.
Number 597. 597.
Oh,
Psalmie number 165. 165.
Our scripture reading this afternoon will come from John chapter 6, verses 66 through 69. If you'd like to follow in your pew Bible, that's page 945. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also want to go away?" But Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God."
Amen. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you just thanking you for the many blessings that you've given to us, for the ability and the chance to gather as your church again today to worship you and sing praises to you and worship you, the one true and living God. Lord, we pray that as we've begun this service, that we'll give you the glory and the honor that you alone deserve. Lord, we're so thankful for your provision for us, for your plan for us, for your faithfulness towards us, despite our lack of faith. And Lord, may we get strength from you. May we learn to love you properly. May we learn to love each other properly so that we can be the Christians that you've called us to be. Lord, we pray that you'll be with Matt as he delivers our lesson. Help him to have a ready recollection of what he has to say to enrich our lives through your word. We just pray that you'll help us as we leave this place and go back to our places of work or school, wherever we be, Lord. We know that you're with us, and we just pray that you'll help us to remember that each and every day. Everything that we say and do, you see and hear. And it's all through Jesus we pray. Amen.
If you would like to mark the song of invitation, it's number 752, 752, and then let's stand together and sing number 522, 522.
I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and Good evening, or afternoon. Appreciate you all being here today as we continue to worship God. Last night we had a Devo over at our house and shared a quote with the kids from Brother Gus Nichols, who said, "I do not decide on Sunday morning whether I'm going to go to church or not. I made that decision 50 years ago." And I'm glad that there's a lot of us in this room that made that decision a long time ago. And if you're visiting with us, and you haven't made that decision or are thinking about that decision, I hope that you'll make this a part of your regular week, being here with us and this family. Does Jesus have the words of life? I was reading a list of the 150 greatest movie quotes this week. And just for fun, kind of looking through there, which ones have I seen? You know, which of those kind of bring back memories of me either seeing that movie growing up or even if it's in recent years, and thinking, you know, whether I even liked that movie or not, or whether it was a great movie, or whether that's even a line that should be remembered as a great movie quote. I just wanted to share a few with you, and maybe some of these will jump out at you. May the force be with you. There's no place like home. I'm the king of the world. More recently, Elementary, my dear Watson. Something my dad would say almost every morning that I got up, and I'm not kidding. It's alive! For the thousandth time, yeah. Thank you. Mom always said life was like a box of chocolates. I'll be back. You're going to need a bigger boat. Some of us were horrified watching that movie. Here's looking at you, kid, going way back. There's no crying in baseball. A line that probably made a lot of us laugh. E.T. phone home. You can't handle the truth. I would say it like Jack Nicholson, but I wouldn't do it justice. If you build it, he will come. A lot of people say if you build it, they will come. It's he will come. No, I am your father. What we've got here is a failure to communicate. You talking to me? Here's Johnny, another one from Jack Nicholson. Nobody puts baby in the corner. You're killing me, Smalls. Say that to students, they have no idea what I'm talking about. I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore. Probably the next one will creep a lot of us out. Two simple words, but if you remember how it was said, they're here. I feel the need for speed. Yo, Adrian. Some of y'all's favorite. Go ahead, make my day. Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship. Number one on the list, and we won't finish this one, but it's frankly, my dear, and we'll stop there. But that was number one on the list. And you know, I think younger people today may be looking at this list, there'd be a lot of them where maybe you'd be wondering, where's To Infinity and Beyond? Or, you know, some of the ones that I watched growing up. And they try to update these lists and try to give people the opportunity as years goes by to see something maybe that strikes something in them. Like, hey, I remember seeing that movie, and that is a good line. You know, I started thinking this week, if I were to make a list of, you know, not the top 150, but maybe the top 30, top 20, maybe just a top 10 of quotes that I could take from the Bible that have been important to me and that have stood out to me. I thought of a lot of them, a couple of them from John the Baptist. You know, here someone is coming that whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. I also love it when he says, he must increase and I must decrease. That's just, it's not just a line, it's true. It's not a movie quote. It's something that I just love. Here am I, send me. I think of Judah and Tamar, where Judah said, she has been more righteous than I. That's maybe more of an obscure one. A lot of them would come from Jesus. And I would probably dare say, if get to the top 20, and he would probably fill most of those. It is finished. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Throw Peter in there from the scripture reading. To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. What do you think my, I haven't made the list yet, but I can just tell you what's number one, and I really don't think I'll find something that would top it. What are you thinking in your head right now as you try to think of some of the things from scripture that stand out to you? If you want to turn to John chapter 11, number one on my list would be, I am the resurrection and the life. And again, you might have that up there. You may have something just ahead of that. I don't think you'd be wrong for it. But I just think about this verse and what it means for us and just how powerful it is and the fact that it's just not some movie quote where it could be remembered just as a line from a movie that I saw several times. If you look at John chapter 11, starting at verse 23, Jesus says, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him in verse 24, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Again, if I were making a list, it wouldn't just be some silly list of quotes that I've seen from movies more than once. And I started thinking also kind of along the lines of these movie quotes. Some of those, I've seen that movie 10 times, 15 times, 20 times. I mean, I don't know how many times just Rocky has come on TV and I've at least caught most of it. You know, they just had all 35 of them playing the other day, one Saturday or whatever it was. There's some of them, and I start to think, well, how many times, if I could think, have I read through Matthew or Mark or Luke or John? How many times have I read through those Gospels? I know it's multiple times, but would any of them be more than the movie that I've seen the most? I'm ashamed to say, I don't think so. I think there's some movies that I've seen more than I have read the words of Jesus Christ. And I know at times, I spent a lot of my life outside of the body of Christ, so there were times where I watched movies over and over and over again because I enjoyed that movie, and you know, maybe just on a particular night, hey, I just want to throw this movie in. I like this movie. It makes me feel good. It makes me laugh, whatever the case may be. But now, at this point in my life, is it a movie that I'm looking for some quote or from something that makes me happy or that gets me excited? Or am I seeking the true words of life? I am the resurrection. What does this mean for us? Well, look at the context of what it meant then. You have a man here who has died, and Martha is saying, I believe, you know, that one day he will rise again. I believe that. I believe you have the power in the resurrection, where people are going to be risen and be with you eternally. And Jesus stops her and just says, I am the resurrection. And that means right now in your life, whatever it is that you need, whatever you're struggling with, I am that. I'm the power for that. I'm the power to fix that in your life. There are people dealing, even in this room, with serious issues right now, whether you've lost a loved one or dealing with serious health issues. Maybe things aren't going on as well at work as you'd like them to be. Maybe there's somebody in this room that's been laid off or that's looking for work. Whatever our issues are, if Jesus is the power of the resurrection, then what is he in that much minor situation compared to death? He has conquered death for us. He's not only the resurrection, but he is the life. He wants us to live now. I just want to encourage you this week, before you grab that movie, which, by the way, I have done in recent weeks. Oh, that, I haven't seen that in a long time. Let me watch that. There's been a couple movies in the last few weeks that I've pulled out and watched just because it's been a long time. And I just, what about if I pick this up and say, you know what, it's been a while since I have read through Matthew. You know, it's been a while since I've read through John. If you're sitting in here and there's any part of God's word that you have yet to read, I would make that a focus right now in your life. There is something that God has uttered to us to give us life. And if you're sitting in here and you haven't read it yet, right now I would make a decision to say, this week and the upcoming weeks, yeah, I've never read the major prophets, and I'm probably going to be confused and not understand a lot of things, but I'm reading through them right now. Amen. I'm reading through the minor prophets. I'm going to read, if you've never read the four gospels, start there maybe and read Jesus' life and the things that he did for people and the way that he gave and he served. And as was mentioned this morning, never did anything wrong and they still killed him. Why? Read that story and find out why. Find out why people were so angry with him and why they wanted to put him to death and what that ultimate death means for you and me. Before you grab that movie or that TV show this week, I'm not telling you not to watch it, but maybe you stop yourself and say, you know what? Before I get into this half-hour show or watch this movie, I really haven't read much today from the living words of our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and I'm going to do that first. And if I've got time after that, I'll watch another episode of such and such, or I'll pull out that movie, or I'll watch a movie I haven't seen yet to maybe see if there's another great quote that will live on while we're still here on this earth. I encourage you to do that. I'm encouraging myself to do that. Before I reach for that movie that came out in 84, which is cheesy now anyway, you know, as I watch through it, and some of them I have recently, and just you're watching through it, and this was silly. How did we ever think this was cool or whatever? But it still brings back that nostalgia and makes us feel good. But this right here doesn't just make you feel good. These are the words of your life. These are the words that save you and me in the end. If you're here tonight and you need our help at all, we'll pray for you. We'll baptize you into Christ if that's a need that you haven't met yet. We want you to know our Savior. We want you to know these words. And if you've been a faithful member for decades, never get sick of this. It's the words of life. If you have any need at all, please come together as we stand and sing.
Next song will be number 399. Lord's Supper has been left prepared for those who have not partaken. If you pass through the double doors on the side of the auditorium, you'll be directed to where you can partake. 399. Closing prayer.
Please bow. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for giving us another opportunity to come and hear another portion of your word. Please help for us to take what Matt said and apply it to our lives and read your word instead of stuff we think we want to do or we think feels better in that time. Thank you for letting us fellowship with each other, and please be with us as we leave, and please forgive us for all of our sins. In Jesus' name, amen.